Okay, good morning to my colleagues and our students here in the US, and good evening to our colleagues and friends in India. Thank you very much for joining us today for the joint webinar series between Binghamton University and Vellore Institute of Technology. Dean Vasudevan from VIT and myself are very delighted to co-host this webinar and welcome all of you to participate in this joint webinar series that covers various topics from advanced manufacturing systems to material science and engineering to solar cells and many more topics. Today, we're very delighted to welcome you to attend the sixth seminar. And today we are honored to have Dr. Nirmala Grace, who is a professor at Vellore Institute of Technology. She's also the director for the Center for Nanotechnology Research at VIT. Dr. Nirmala Grace completed her PhD in chemistry from the University of Madras, India, and a postdoctoral research from Korea Institute of Energy Research in South Korea. Her current research interests include hybrid nanomaterials for energy storage and harvesting, advanced nanomaterials, 2D materials, fabrication of electrodes for DSSC, flexible energy devices, CO2 conversion, and electrochemical sensor. Dr. Nirmala Grace has more than 130 international peer-reviewed publications, has authored 3 book chapters and many conference publications. Dr. Nirmala Grace is on the editorial board for journals like Scientific Reports, which is a Nature journal, and IET Nanobiotechnology journal as well, and many more. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Nirmala Grace to this joint webinar series. And Dr. Nirmala Grace, I'll turn it over to you.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Mohammed, for the nice introduction. So let me just share my screen. So thank you once again, Dr. Mohammed, for the nice introduction. So it's my pleasure to give a talk in my research area on platinum metal nitride alternative counter electrodes, typically for disensitized solar cells. But being the director for the center, let me introduce my center to all of you. So our center basically, it's Center for Nanotechnology Research, and we are working with an emphasis on flexible electronic devices for energy sensors and healthcare. And like, for instance, we have a team of transdisciplinary faculty members from different backgrounds, cater to the need of working in an interdisciplinary environment. Coming to materials, we have the state-of-the-art materials for fabricating, and as well as for the growth of zero-dimensional, one-dimensional, and two-dimensional nanomaterials via various techniques. And in terms of energy, our center is very strong in energy devices. Like, for instance, we are good at fabrication of electrodes in terms of like solar cells, disensitized perovskite solar cells, and flexible, again, supercapacitors. And again, we have a team of faculty members working on hydrogen production, photoelectrochemical water splitting, solar fuels, etc. And coming to sensors, again, we have a small team working on various aspects of sensors, again, on the flexible level. As well as we have few different projects on nanofluids for automobiles and solar collectors. And a small group, again, we are a very strong group working on the biomedical applications of nanotechnology as well. So, and talking about the environmental aspects, we make sure that we always work for some societal reason, extending our nanotechnological approach. So in that concept, we are working on, for instance, on water purification, as well as on e-waste management. And very recently, we have started a unit for agriculture, how nanotechnology could be contributing to it. Like, for instance, on nanofertilizers, precision farming, and crop improvements, etc. And apart from the materials engineering synthesis and fabrication facilities, we have a very strong dedicated computational material science group, who are working on graphene plasmonics and band gap engineered 2D materials like on nanoelectronics, as well as modeling on membranes. So with that, with a short introduction, let me just go to my talk on disensitized solar cells. Yeah. So for like Dyson Stay Solar Cells, like talking about the solar energy, we all know like sustainable development is a huge challenge, a major challenge for the planet, and the energy is the single most important challenge that humanity is confronted with today. For instance, by 2050, it is expected that the annual world energy consumption is projected to be around 27.6 terawatt per year. And among all the renewable energy technologies, photovoltaic technology is considered as the most promising one. And with its inception in 1950s, it is really growing over leaps and bounds, like, you know, over finite conventional fossil fuels, supplies and carbon emissions. Like the solar energy in our nation India has really concentrating on this solar energy, and India is aiming at around 100 gigawatt solar energy to be installed by 2022. And there's a huge growth of this technology in our nation with the, like for instance, in 2019, India has installed around 7.3 gigawatts of solar power across the country, establishing its position as the third largest solar market in the world. And so this is the NREL graph, which says the cell efficiency in terms of different types of generations. Like for instance, the purple one, this is all the first generation multi-junction solar cells. And then comes the, these are the multi-junction solar cells, which accounts for the highest efficiency. But the high cost involved in the multi-junction solar cells, that's the first generation solar cells, has really led to the development of second generation and third generation solar cells in terms of the cost involved and in terms of the materials involved as well. So these are the third generation solar cells, also called as emerging photovoltaics. Typically, as you can see here, the efficiency of a perovskite solar cell is around 29.1%. And in the case of Dyson Stay solar cell, it's around 11.4%. So the cost and efficiency, however, it cannot compete with wafer-based silicon devices at present, but the future development of these devices could result in revolutionary developments in photovoltaic technologies. So talking about the silicon efficiency of different generations of solar cells, as I had mentioned, silicon solar cell, for instance, it is really the highest, and but the cost involved really is compelling to develop other types of solar cells like thin film solar cells and Dyson Stay solar cells. And these third generation solar cells are now, it's going to be really the futuristic solar cell in terms of the low cost involved in the manufacturing, as well as the abundance of materials available for the fabrication of such solar cells. For example, if you see, recently the number of publications that's really emerging out in terms of the solar cells are really very high. And in terms of the efficiency of all the various types of solar cells, like for instance, inorganic solar cells, Dyson Stays, organic and perovskite solar cells, obviously perovskites is leading the other types of solar cells and with an appreciable efficiency from the family of Dyson Stay solar cells as well. So let me just give you a brief introduction of what are Dyson Stay solar cells, why Dyson Stay solar cells, and what are the futuristic or the challenges that can be, you know, solved as a material scientist as well as a in terms of nanotechnology as well. So basically, Dyson Stay solar cells, entitled as one of the most prominent third generation solar cells, it stands out in the photovoltaic category because of its excellent properties as listed here. Like for instance, its semi-transparency, higher flexibility, a variety of colors, which is very important. Like for example, its fascinating colors leading to a lot of colorful consumer products, and the low cost of fabrication involved, environmental benign nature of all the materials. So these properties really make solar cells, the DSSC to be really a popular one. And for example, the graph to the right, which is nothing but the spectral response graph of a solar cell, which gives a ratio of the photocurrent generated by the solar cell to the power instant on the solar cell, right? And this solar cell typically depends on certain range of wavelengths. For example, the response at longer wavelengths in the spectrum generally depends on the band gap energy of the solar cell material. And at shorter wavelengths, it depends on the absorption, that is called as the extinction coefficient of the material. So as can be seen here, some of the important properties that Dyson Stay solar cells really came out very promising is the number one is high energy conversion efficiency, the low cost of fabrication. For instance, to fabricate a 10% efficiency based solar cell for 1 wattage, it is around $0.60, which is really very cheap when compared to other types of solar cells. And abundant supply of the component materials, for example, except these ruthenium dyes, all the other components like the photocathodic part, the photoanode part, is all readily available. And even the dye material, the concentration is very low in terms of like 10 power minus 7 mole per centimeter squared. And as I had mentioned, it's colorful consumer products and environmentally benign nature and good recyclability, which is again a very important factor that needs to be considered. These dyes can be again recycled when the solar cells are dipped in alkaline solution. So now coming to the component of a solar cell. So in brief, this is a photoanodic part, which is coated with the wide band gap semiconductor titanium dioxide anchored with dye molecules, organic dye molecules. And on the other side, the cathodic part, again, a transparent TCO substrate, which is loaded with platinum, and electrolyte is sealed between these two particles. So nanoparticles basically play a key role in the development of dye-sensitive solar cells. So these are the components basically, and it was invented by Michael Gredsel and Brian O'Regan in 1988. Yeah. So now working operation of dye-sensitive solar cells. So in brief, before I explain in detail, so there are two processes basically happening in the dye-sensitive solar cell called as a light electricity conversion and the dark reaction. It means that it can happen even in the absence of the light. So coming to light electricity conversion, for example, sensitizer photo excitation, sensitizers are nothing but the dye involved, or it is also called the pigments typically. So number one is, it's given in numbers here to the right of the cartoon. So sensitizer photo excitation, and then electron injection is taking place, electron transportation, oxidized to dye regeneration, and oxidized to redox coupled regeneration. And the dark process, which are happening even in the absence of light, are electron recombination process. It means that electrons, you know, which are sent to the conduction band of the n-type semiconductor and conductor can come back, can recombine with the dye molecule, or it can even recombine with the redox coupled molecules, right? So these are the unwanted reactions which needs to be prevented to have a decent efficiency of a solar cell. And as can be seen here, so the principle of dye-sensitive solar cells, so the first process is the moment light gets incident on the solar cell, that is on the photoanodic part, the dye molecule gets excited, right, from the HOMO, that is highest occupied molecular orbital, to the LUMO, that is lowest unoccupied molecular orbital. So this is called as the absorption step. And the second step is, you can see here, the energy level of this, right, is far negative than compared to the conduction band of titanium dioxide. So this facilitates easy transfer of these electrons to the conduction band of titanium dioxide. So this process is called as electron injection process. And now, before the electron, now it percolates through the titanium dioxide, reaches the transparent conducting oxide, and then via the external circuit, it has to reach cathode. But before it reaches the cathode, the dye which has gone to the excited state or the LUMO state has to relax to the HOMO state for the second cycle to get initiated, right? So that is called as regeneration process. So before the electron reaches here, to make the dye molecule reach, go back to the ground state, it takes an electron from the called as the electrolyte, that is iodine triiodide complex. So this electrolyte gives electron, that is called as a regeneration step, wherein the dye molecules, basically they are regenerated back. And once these electrolytes, for instance, this is iodide and this is triiodide, right? And the dye molecules are now regenerated back. But again, this triiodide has to go back to the iodide form so that start the second cycle. So cathode does the job with the help of platinum. Triiodide, it takes the electron, which is coming from the other end of the circuit, and it goes back to the iodide form, thereby completing the circuit. So this is the entire process, which is happening via absorption, electron injection, and then regeneration, and then reaction that is happening at the cathode. Yeah. But there are always certain reactions which yields, which destroys the efficiency or which impedes the efficiency. For example, incident light harvesting by the dye. Dye is the main part of the solar cell, which actually triggers on the entire reaction. So the dye should be really efficient to absorb all the visible light. And there is insufficient or inefficient charge transfer injection into the titanium dioxide, again, it impedes the reaction. And if there is an inefficient collection of the transported electron, right, across the cathode, again, there is a decrease in the efficiency. So energetics now play a major role in a dye-sensitive solar cell. So what are the following factors needs to be considered? For example, substantial charge transfer to the semiconductor, right, must be carried out at a higher rate. This reaction, that is the electron transfer from LUMO of the dye to the conduction band of titanium dioxide, the kinetics should be really fast enough rather than the electron getting relaxed back, right? So this substantial charge transfer to the semiconductor must be carried out at a faster rate than the rate of decay of electrons. So it means that the LUMO of the dye, that is the excited state. Since it being organic molecule, it's always called as the LUMO, lowest unoccupied molecular orbital of the dye. Typically, it must be more negative or higher in energy than with respect to the conduction band of semiconductor. So this is, one of the preliminary requirements when you are choosing a dye or when you are choosing an N-type semiconductor. And number two is, the conduction band of the semiconductor, again, this should be negative than that of the FTO or transparent conducting oxides, as well as the excited dye. The HOMO should be positive than that of the redox mediators, right? So these are some of the conditions in terms of energetics, so that all these three factors are avoided, thereby increasing the efficiency. Now again, coming to why nanoparticles or the components of a disensitized solar cells. Obviously, nanoparticles are preferred because of strong absorption. Like instance, 20 nanometer titanium dioxide is always used as it can absorb visible light via the dye, not directly. And liquid electrolytes are always preferred over quasi solid state electrolytes or solid state electrolytes because of its ease percolation through this photoanodic material. And platinum coated on the other side, that is on the cathodic part, because platinum is, as we all know, is the best catalyst for any reduction or for any oxidation. And here there is a triiodide reduction is happening on the other side. So platinum is the best. So compared to FTO, FTO is also conductive, but it cannot basically catalyze the reduction of triiodide. So platinum is the best catalyst. So platinum coated on FTO is again needed. And ITO is typically used because of its transparency and because of its high conductivity. Now, so to sum up, for a dye sensitized, these are some of the components like sensitizing dye. And this dye again should be rich with functional groups, organic functional groups, and because of that, it can absorb more amount of visible light. And titanium dioxide, typically 20 nanometer, because this particular size has a good extinction coefficient, as well as the electrolyte used typically here is iodide triiodide complex, because of its again good reversibility for solar cell. Now coming to the fabrication, if you see here, this is a top electrode and this is the back electrode. And the top electrode, which is coated with typically the titanium dioxide, the photoanodic part, and the blue is the dye part. And on the other side of the electrode is typically again this is the TCO, transparent conducting oxide, which is typically coated with again here the platinum, which is nothing but the cathodic material or the electrode needed to complete the circuit. So during fabrication, care must be taken to separate this photo cathode and the photo anode. So the separation is typically done by a spacer material called Serlin, which is like a polymer material. Between the photo cathode and the photo anode, typically electrolytes, the yellow one is inserted. And because electrolyte plays a major role in deciding the efficiency of a disensitized solar cell. Even if there is a liquid, even if there is a leakage, or if the electrolyte is solidified, the efficiency is going to be again decreasing. So a proper spacer must be inserted during fabrication of the disensitized solar cell so that to keep the electrolyte intact. And number two is the electrolyte is always, being corrosive nature. This has to be again, the photo anode and the photo cathode has to be again protected because of the corrosive nature of the electrolytes. So proper injection of the electrolyte into the spacing between the photo cathode and photo anode is very important, which is basically done by injecting through two narrow channels called holes, by drilling holes in the substrate of the back electrode. So now let me explain one by one what are the various components typically involved in a disensitized solar cell. The first important component is a working electrode and the substrates. So substrates, what I mean by substrates is typically the transparent conducting oxides. So DSCs are typically constructed with two sheets of conducting transparent materials, one on the photocathode side and one on the photoanode side. And the substrates necessary, they should be highly transparent. That is the preliminary condition, with at least a transparency of 80% and more, so that it permits the radiation from the electro part of the spectrum. And its electrical conductivity also should be high for efficient charge transfer and to decrease the energy loss. And typically, what are the substrates used is given here. ITO. tin doped indium oxide and fluorine doped tin oxide. So these are the some of the common substrates used because of its good electrical conductivity, high transparency, and low material cost. And talking about the working electrode, that is the photo anodic material. Generally metal oxides are preferred because of its wide band gap. And out of which titanium dioxide is typically used because of its high reflective index and transparency over a wide spectral range. And also it increases the dye pickup rate, light scattering ability, and reduced recombination and improved charge transportability are some of the factors of titanium dioxide. In terms of energetics, if you see its conduction bandage, lies slightly below the excited state of many of the dyes, whatever the many of the organic dyes. So that's the reason titanium dioxide is always preferred over other metal oxides. And its dielectric constant is also high, that is 80 for anatase phase. And so because of this dielectric property, it provides a good electrostatic shielding of the injected electrons, that is from the dye to the semiconductor, and thereby preventing the recombination. So while choosing the photo anodic part, that is on metal oxides, dielectric constant should be taken into factor, because this dielectric constant is going to decide how efficient a solar cell is going to be. And the second important factor is called as the electrolyte, which is like heart of the Dyson stage solar cells. And as we know, the purpose of the electrolyte is typically is to regenerate the dye. Yeah, it's to regenerate the dye after it injects electrons into the conduction band of the semiconductor. And also it also acts as a charge passage medium, right? It through it only charges basically pass to transfer the positive charges towards the counter electrodes. And typically a dye-sensitized solar cell stability, it all depends on the nature of the electrolyte. For example, if there is a leakage of the electrolyte happening in a dye-sensitized solar cell, or if it gets solidified at higher temperature during its operation, so the complete efficiency is worn out, right? So if the whole stability of a solar cell, that is dye-sensitized solar cell, typically depends on the electrolyte, and which is typically, the electrolyte should have, it should be a pure liquid typically. Low viscous, that's very important. If it's high viscous, again, there won't be any charge carrier transportation possible, as well as if it's less viscous, again, there's a chance of leakage from the cell, right? And obviously, it should have a high boiling point and a melting point of minus 20 degrees Celsius. And therefore, these are some of the properties an electrolyte should have in a Dyson stage solar cell. Like, for example, in a nutshell, it should have high electrical conductivity, low viscosity for faster diffusion of electrons, and it should have a good interfacial contact. That's very important with the semiconductor, right? These electrolytes should peep through the photo anode and photo cathode, and this should not be, the electrolyte should not be the cause of desorption of the dye. And it should not absorb. Basically, electrolyte should be transparent to the visible region. So though there are a lot of electrolytes available, iodide system, triiodide system typically is used because of its excellent solubility in various solvents like acetonitrile, propionitrile, etc. But typically acetonitrile is used, preferred over other solvents. And it has suitable redox potentials, very slow recombination kinetics between the injected electrons into the semiconductor and the triiodide. And the next component again in a dye-sensitized solar cell is called as sensitizers or dyes, or it's also called as pigments. So the purpose of the dye, as I had explained earlier, is to absorb the light from the electromagnetic radiation, photons, and they exchange electrons to the conduction band of the semiconductor, that is titanium dioxide. And therefore, it is chemically bonded to the porous surface of this semiconductor. And to achieve a high light to energy conversion, to have a good photo energy conversion efficiency of a DSSC, these are some of the properties that needs to be taken care of, like absorption, energetics, kinetics, stability, interfacial properties, and practical properties. So what are they? Talking about absorption, first of all, see, the dye is basically is the one which is going to trigger on the reaction. This is the one which is going to absorb the photon and pass on the first electron to the semiconductor. So this is where reaction is going to get started. So it should have typically a wide range of absorption, at least near infrared, like 400 to 900 nanometers. And how it is possible? For example, it is possible by choosing a dye which has abundant functional groups on the surface. Like, for example, this particular N71 dye has a lot of carboxylic molecules on the moieties, which will again, these groups will make more absorption in the visible region, right? So all these properties, it should basically have a high extinction coefficient. Number two is energetics. So as I had told you, to minimize the energy losses and to maximize the photovoltaic, the excited state of the die, that is the LUMO of the die typically, should be only slightly above the conduction bandage of the titanium dioxide. So this energetic should be properly maintained, as well as the HOMO should be below the level of the electrolyte. This is again very important. And talking about the kinetics, kinetics means the speed of the reaction. So the speed with which the electron is being injected into the conduction band of titanium dioxide is very important. If the speed is less, what happens is that the electrons may drop back to the ground level or the HOMO level, that is called relaxation, then the entire process is worn out. So kinetics again is very important. So, and the stability, the die should be basically stability for almost, you know, 20 years of operation typically. And then interfacial properties, what are interfacial properties? Like it should have a good adherence to the semiconductor, it should properly, you know, adhere. And this adherence again is achieved via these functional groups anchored onto the dye molecules typically. And finally, practical properties, like for instance, its solubility in solvent, typically acetonitrile, it should be good enough. In the market, there are three kinds of photosensitizers, typically metal-based sensitizers, metal-free organic sensitizers, natural sensitizers, like for example, you know, dye from fruits like blueberry, etc., and metal complex stabilizers. So for anything, for almost all the dyes, typically the main property of a dye is to cover the entire visible and a near infrared section of the solar spectrum. And so typically ruthenium dyes are preferred over other dyes because of all the properties what a dye should be having, like from absorption to the practicality in terms of the solubility. And the final part of the component of a dye sensitized solar cell, which I'm going to talk about in the next few slides, are counter electrodes, also called as photocathodes. So typically, as I had mentioned, platinum is used because of the two reasons. Platinum is the best catalyst for the regeneration of iodine from triiodide. And number two is for the collection of electrons from the external load to the electrolyte. So this should be perfectly conductive, as well as it should be perfectly a good electrocatalyst as well. So seeing all the elements, we all know that platinum is basically the best catalyst for any reaction, any reduction reaction, as well as the highest conductive. See, instead of platinum, FTO can also do the job, transparent conducting oxides, but this iron triiodide reduction is not possible in transparent conducting oxides. So typically for that, platinum is always used, a preferred counter electrode. But the main disadvantage is, for example, the entire cost of the solar cell, right? It's is due to the platinum. For example, cost of platinum is 40% of the whole dye sensitized solar cell. And the electrolyte, iodine triiodide system, typically is slightly corrosive. And because of that, for long-term application, for long-term usage during the fabrication of a solar cell, this is small corrosion being happening at the platinum surface, which deteriorates the long-term stability completely. Yeah, so these drawbacks basically restrict the large-scale applications of platinum electrode in a dye sensitized solar cell, and it's very imperative now to develop alternative, noble metal-free materials that are capable of replacing platinum as electrocatalyst. So these are all the properties what I had mentioned, and the benchmark characteristics of a counter electrode when you're choosing alternative electrode. So these properties should be really kept in mind, with a minimum of maximum of 80% of optical or transparency, and 20 ohm square sheet resistance, and this charge transfer resistance. Obviously platinum is a good, but because of its stability issue and because of the cost factor, there are a lot of research now coming on to replace. Is it possible to replace the costly platinum noble metal electrode? The answer is yes. And so thus, in a nutshell, to sum up, these are the four factors. If you're really interested in starting a research on dye sensitized solar cells, these are the four components where research is going on, either on the photo anodic part on different metal oxides by fine-tuning the band gap engineering of these metal oxides, or in terms of the electrolytes, or in terms of the dye molecules. See, dye is again very important. By tuning the, or by making functionalization of the dye, it can be really shifted to different wavelength, to near IR also. And the fourth component, what I'll be talking about in the next 30 minutes, is on the photocathodic part or the platinum, because in terms of cost, right? So now, requirements of counter electrode, as I had mentioned, these are some of the properties. It should have a low charge transfer resistance, a high surface area. It should have a porous nature to have a good efficiency, and optimum thickness is very important. High reflectance, high current exchange current density. Obviously, it should be conductive, and it should be mechanically stable as well. And it should be electrochemically stable, which is a very important factor. And so by seeing the literature, there are a lot of materials that has been researched, for instance, on carbon materials, carbon nanotubes, graphene, polymers, etc. And a lot of materials which I'll be talking about. But transition metal nitrates is one material, you know, which was showing an excellent catalytic activity, as they contain a small atom nitrogen. And it was also reported in literatures that it was showing platinum-like electrocatalytic properties. So that triggered us, you know, to search different kinds of transition metal nitrates as well as carbides, because of its excellent properties like high melting temperature and durability towards a covalent solid, and very important, it's having platinum-like catalytic activity. Yeah. So before I move on to our research work, let me just show some of the various other materials used as proposed as counter electrodes for a disensitized solar cell. For example, number one is carbon electrodes. We all know that carbon materials are completely universally accepted material for an electrochemical device system, and because of its low cost, high catalytic activity, high electrical conductivity, high thermal stability, good corrosion resistance, which is again one of the very important factor for a disensitized solar cell, that it should not get corroded in an electrolyte. So carbon was really promising, and it was also having a low sheet resistance. But the main drawback is it requires a lot of dosage. What I mean is you need a thicker film of carbon material to be fabricated on the transparent conducting oxide, and that again increases the cost of the material. And there's a poor connection between the carbon film and the substrate, means that the adhesivity is not proper when carbon is being used, even graphene, though its conductivity is good. But the adhesion factor and the usage of large dosage of materials prevented the usage of carbon electrodes towards practical applications in fabricating a DSSC. And then came the polymer electrodes were also researched. For example, again, polymer is just similar to carbon electrodes with appreciable electronic conductivity. And you can see from the table here, there are a lot of polymers being researched, polyaniline, polypyrrole, pyrrole polymers, and composite polymers typically. And we showed an efficiency, like polypyrrole was good with an efficiency of 7.773, which was closer to platinum. But still, again, it was having the same problem in terms of the stability, because polymers, as we all know, it's highly electrochemically active, and it may tend to, again, get oxidized over a number of cycles. So if it is for one cycle, it's fine. But if it's for a longer cycle of operation, polymers, again, are not preferred. So this is, again, from the literature on various carbon materials. For example, you can see here, this is on carbon nanotubes, which is showing good result, 7.61. And the counterpart, with using platinum, it was 7.83. So this was almost equivalent to or slightly lesser than platinum. So it's a good material. But as I had mentioned, carbon was typically it cannot be used for commercial applications because of its adhesion property, as well as polymers. Polypyrrole was showing good result, which was closer to platinum, or for here in the instance it is slightly greater than platinum. And again, there are a lot of research that came into existence, like use of metal compounds like oxides, sulfides, phosphates, and composites. So there are a lot of metal oxides and metal sulfates, chalcogenase, triders, counter electrodes typically. And one good result was obtained for tungsten oxide, 8.03. But the main drawback, again, for this oxide, sulfides, phosphates, and composite materials involving all these materials are typically, again, it's electrochemical stability. These materials are electrochemically very active, and sometimes they tend to undergo, there are a lot of redox reactions also. It may be happening when we are using oxides or sulfides. So that again is preventing the use of such materials as the counter electrodes in a DSSC. And the last category of materials are transition metal nitrates and carbides. As I had mentioned, it's mechanically highly stable and durable, and it has high melting temperature as well as good electrical and thermal behavior. So in the table, as can be seen here, tungsten carbide was showing an appreciable efficiency, photocurrent efficiency of 7.01, whereas the counterpart platinum was having 8.23%, as well as titanium nitrate again was showing 7.73. So all these results triggered us to really think of materials from transition metal nitrates and carbides. So before moving on to our research work, so the primary factor or the primary test typically for a DSSC device is a typical cyclic voltammetry test to understand whether the material what we have chosen is a good material as a counter electrode for a disensitized solar cell. So running a cyclic voltammetry typically in iodine triiodide system, acetonitrile, we'll be getting these two peaks. Like for instance, the black one is for the perfect platinum. So this particular peak, that is the ox one and the red one, it denotes this equation, that is triiodide reduction to iodide, which is nothing but this reaction corresponds to the regeneration of the dye molecule, that is taking not the dye molecule, regeneration of the electrolyte taking place at the cathode, right? So this is these peaks denote the efficiency of the reaction that is taking place at the cathode. And these are the anodic reactions typically. Now, so the other peak, which is not of importance, the first peak basically decides the electrocatalytic ability of a material that it can be used as a counter electrode typically. And another important factor is the difference between the ox one and the red one peak, that is called as a EPP or delta EP, peak to peak separation. This should be typically less. It should be less potential because this peak denotes the triiodide reduction to iodide. And if the reduction is pretty good enough, quick, what happens is that the delta EP will be less. So less the delta EP, it means that more electrocatalytically active the electrode is. Yeah. Now, we have chosen metal carbides and nitrates. So as you can see from the graph here, so typically of the various materials, I mean, the efficiency of platinum is here somewhere 7.5, and vanadium carbide and, made as a composite with various other metal carbides, basically it's equivalent to platinum and sometimes is, exceeding the efficiency of platinum as well. So, and again, these are the cyclic voltammetry graphs. This is again from the literature on various carbides. So as you can see here, all these materials are electrocatalytically very active in terms of, these two peaks. And you can see here the peak-to-peak separation is very less in terms of titanium carbide. And again, for vanadium carbide and metal carbide composite material. So all these results are, showing that carbides and nitrates are typically a good alternative electrode. And these are again the efficiency what I discussed earlier. There is a photocurrent efficiency JV curves. Typically, this particular material was very good in showing the result. And what I had told you, this is again the same thing in the table. And so few papers, these are some of the few papers like on use of alternative other materials. For example, this is on chalcogenides, which was not showing that appreciable result because of its instability. And this is on nickel nitrates as well. See, it's not all nitrates are typically giving good results. That is what I wanted to convey. So for example, nickel nitrates, you can see here the peak to peak separation is pretty high enough and the efficiency is very less, 1.38. So how to combat this problem or how to increase the efficiency when we are using this metal nitrates or carbides? So this is yet another paper, where authors have been showing the effect of the surface roughness of the electrode, typically electrode in the sense the photocathode or the counter electrode, where the authors have used basically nickel nitrate coated nickel foam, which is called as nitridide nickel foam. And the electrodes for the normal electrode, just the nickel nitrate electrode, the reduction peak current, it was almost 1.6, whereas if it is dipped in sulfuric acid and nitric acid, so what happens is that basically it increases the surface roughness of the electrode. So surface roughness, obviously, as we know, it increases the surface area and it can capture more number of electrons. And because of that, the efficiency is typically, not efficiency, I'm sorry, the current density typically increases from minus 1.6 to minus 2.52 or milliamp per centimeter squared. So thereby increasing the efficiency. So this is one solution when we are using nitrates or carbides to increase efficiency, to increase number one is to increase the roughness. And number two solution for increasing the efficiency is making a composite with a conducting polymer. So what is the need of it to make a composite typically? See, titanium nitrates or any nitrates, say for instance, any material deposited on an electrode, fabricated on an electrode, typically will have a large grain size. And there may be a tendency for agglomeration because they are all in nano form. Right, to prevent that agglomeration, it's like a stabilizer again being introduced, this P dot PSS, provided this should be conductive. And by making a composite with the carbides or nitride materials with the polymer, the authors have really increased the efficiency from 0.76 to 10 times higher, 7.06, which is higher than the conventional platinum electrode, which is just only 6.57. So these are the two solutions. One is the surface roughness and making a composite, or making a composite with the conductive polymer. Now let me just move on to our work, what work we have done in a research group. After going through all these literatures, we started working on vanadium nitrates, basically. From vanadium oxides. So typically before moving on to the vanadium oxide, vanadium nitrates, we thought we'll test with the vanadium oxide nanofibers, so which actually got published in this journal. So typically to start with, we prepared vanadium oxide nanofibers, which is just not vanadium oxide nanofibers. It is carbon wrapped vanadium oxide nanofibers. See, because carbon is a material which gives a good property like corrosion resistance. So we thought if incorporating with our vanadium nitride material, so this was carbon wrapped vanadium oxide nanofibers prepared by the electrospinning unit, and then it was converted to vanadium nitrate. But before that, we wanted to test what is the viability of this vanadium oxide nanofibers towards the Dyson Stay solar cells. Yeah, these are the material and morphological characterizations to show that nanofibers are formed. Let me just briefly tell the fabrication part of the photoanode typically. So the FTO substrates, you know, typically are cleaned and deposited with titanium dioxide and then immersed in a dye solution. This would be better. So typically this is these are some of the protocols. For instance, for the photocathode FTO substrate, which is drilled, as I had told you, the spaces are very important, which is going to decide the efficiency between the photoanode and the photocathode. So this FTO is drilled, and then the completely the electrode is platinized to get a platinum counterpart, and then to make the photoanode, FTO glasses typically coated with the titanium dioxide and then immersed in N71 dye solution to have the photoanode, and both the materials are now sealed with a spacer. So this the yellow part is called as a spacer, called the Serlin spacer, which is going to separate the photocathode and the photoanode. And through the holes, through the drilled holes, electrolytes are being injected. The liquid electrolytes are injected and then sealed and then clipped to form the final solar cell. So this is a simple schematic. And these are some of the snapshots of our work, how we fabricated for photoanode as well as the photocathode via a simple doctor blade technique method. And annealing process is very important after titanium dioxide, because this annealing is going to really help titanium dioxide get deposited uniformly on the substrate, so that proper absorption as well as scattering of light is taking place on the photoanode process. And so finally, this is the final structure. It's clipped and then tested in a solar simulator. And since it's a laboratory testing, the active area was less in this 0.16 centimeters squared. And so this was the electrolyte, iodine iodide system in 4 tertiary butyl pyridine in solvent acetonitrile, which was sandwiched and was tested. And before testing, so these are some of the counter electrode characterization techniques. There are two types of techniques. One is the electrode level characterization, and then solar testing, that is the solar device level characterization. So for the electrode level characterization, as I had mentioned earlier, cyclic voltammetry obviously is the preliminary technique to find out whether the electrode is typically good for or can be considered as a counter electrode for a Dyson Stay solar cell. And which it should be basically giving two peaks, the OX1 and the REDONE peak, as I had mentioned earlier. And then TAFL polarization, which is another imperative technique to find the kinetics of the reaction as well as the activity of the material. And impedance measurements will tell me the resistance, that is the charge transfer resistance, the solution resistance that is developed at the solar cell. And the other important parameter, that is device level characterization, these are some of the important parameters. Again here, see, basically generation of electrical power under illumination is achieved by the capability of the photovoltaic device to produce voltage or external load and current through the load at the same time. So this is done by this JV curve or PV curve or IV curve. For example, when the cell is short circuited under illumination, the maximum current, that is the short circuit current, is called as JSC or ISC in terms of current or current density is generated. Whereas open circuit potential is typically is a difference in potential between the two terminals in the cell under light illumination when the circuit is open. And yet another important factor is the fill factor, which is going to decide the overall capabilities of the cell. Right, it describes the quality and idealness of a solar cell, which is nothing but the maximum power divided by the open circuit potential into the short circuit current. And finally, the efficiency is calculated by from the fill factor into 100%, which will be giving the efficiency. So Since it is dependent on all these three factors under standard conditions, it is of great importance to optimize each of the each factors, you know, for to obtain an overall efficiency like open circuit potential, short circuit current, and how to increase the fill factor of the cell, etc. Now, coming to our results on vanadium oxides, typically as can be seen in the figure, as I had told you, the preliminary test is a cyclic voltammetry test to ascertain whether the electrode is a good electrode or it can be used as a counter electrode, alternative counter electrode for disensitized solar cell. So as can be seen here, the peak to peak separation for platinum is 520 volts, whereas for our fabricated electrode is 741 volts, which is typically not a good value because EPP should be less, but the current density was slightly higher compared to platinum. It might be due to because of the fibrous one-dimensional structure as well as the carbon coated on the material, the porous nature of the material, or the roughness that has been created, and the catalytically activity is because of the carbon that the activity is slightly high. And the figure to the right, you see, is the cyclic voltammetry again at different scan rates for iodine triiodide reduction, and the shape of the CV curve, its peak position is just similar to platinum, and you can see the lot of overlapped CV peaks at constant anodic and cathodic peak current, which reveals that this material possesses good electrochemical stability. See, basically this scan rate studies at different cycles is will tell us the chemical stability as well as electrochemical stability, its reversibility towards the electrolyte, and strong adhesion. If there is a poor adhesion, typically such peaks will not be obtained. So it means that the vanadium oxide, though it is showing less efficiency, but in terms of stability, in terms of current density, it was slightly you know, good as comparable to platinum. And now this is called as the EAS, electrochemical impedance spectroscopy. So basically the intrinsic charge transfer and the transport kinetics that is taking place across the interface of electrode and the electrolyte, because there is a solid liquid interface is happening. So whenever there is a solid liquid interface, obviously there will be a solution resistance and charge transfer resistance taking place. So here we can see there are two semicircles. Semicircle in the higher frequency region is due to the contribution of the Helmholtz capacitance, because charges are being stored, as well as there is a charge transfer resistance can be found out from the semicircle. And the diameter of the higher frequency semicircle, it gives the value of RCT. RCT is called as charge transfer resistance, basically, which is a very important factor. And the semicircle in the lower frequency typically is due to Nernst diffusion impedance, which tells the diffusion of electrons, the charge carriers that is taking place. And the intercept, you know, to the x-axis will give me the RS. RS is nothing but the ohmic series resistance, or also called as the solution resistance, which is nothing but the intrinsic resistance due to the combined contribution of the conductive FTO, substrate resistance, and the lead contact resistance. So as you can see here, platinum is having a slightly lesser resistance compared to our fabricated material. So as seen from the table, the solution resistance of our proposed material is 4.30, which is slightly higher than the platinum, as well as the charge transfer resistance is again higher than the platinum. And efficiency was found to be slightly less because of the high resistance, both solution as well as the charge transfer resistance. And the plot to the right, this is called as a Tafel polarization plot, which is basically used to understand the charge transfer kinetics, the speed at which the electrons are being pumped into the semiconductor, and that being pumped across the circuit to the photo cathode. So it is telling the charge transfer kinetics at the interface of the counter electrode and the electrolyte, right? It's not at the photo anodic, but it is at the counter electrode electrolyte. As we are proposing new counter electrode, Tafel plot is very important. So Tafel plot, typically it has three regions. This region is called as a polarization region. That is the voltage typically less than 120 millivolts. And the second region, or the middle region, which is a very important region, this is called as the Tafel region or the middle zone, which has a very sharp slope and which determines the catalytic activity of the electrode as well. And the third region is called as the diffusion region, which evaluates the electrode ion diffusion. So the parameters that can be extracted from this plots are basically exchange current density J0 and what is called as limiting current density, limiting diffusion current density, can be illustrated from this polarization plot, which further validates. These values will tell me the electrochemical performance of the counter electrode in a disensitized solar cell. So tangential plot to this slope, if we take, we can find typically J0 and J limitation, that is the limiting diffusion current. And typically For a good counter electrode, it should have a higher J0 value. J0 is nothing but a higher current density, as well as it should have a high limiting diffusion current density, because you know, it depends on the diffusion coefficient of the redox couple in the electrolyte. So as observed in the figure here, the diffusion zone, you know, showed a slightly higher J limitation for platinum. Platinum is the black one, so it was slightly high, the current density, than for the proposed material, which means that diffusion is happening properly or in a very good manner in the case of the conventional platinum, and not in vanadium oxide. But it is not a worse material. It was showing almost not equivalent, but appreciable efficiency with respect to the platinum. And then finally, the JV characteristics. The solar cell was fabricated to finally find the fill factor and the efficiency. So, I mean, this is what is called as the limitation, J in, and the power input, the power, maximum power, and this is for an ideal cell, right? And so this is from this plot, I mean, to the x-axis intercept will give me the VOC, the open circuit potential, and the short circuit current. By using the formula, the efficiency was calculated to be typically 6.53, which was comparable to that of the platinum, conventional platinum. And as I had mentioned, our interest was on, you know, to probe the vanadium nitrate materials. So initially we were thinking, before moving on to the vanadium nitrates, typically to see what is happening with vanadium oxides. But later on we moved to vanadium nitrates, because as vanadium oxides was not giving the best efficiency or comparable efficiency to platinum. So, and the next part of the work, we were thinking to, you know, work on vanadium nitrate, basically on nanopetals. The morphology was quite good. And so this is, again, this is the synthetic protocol for preparation from melamine. We synthesized vanadium nitrates, which was having a unique morphology. And so again, it's the same thing, I'm just not repeating. So it's a cyclic voltammetry test where EPP, which can be found by the difference between the EP anodic and EP cathodic, which was almost, as you can see here, VNNP, that is vanadium nitrate nanopetals, typically showed a EPP, that is a peak-to-peak separation of 0.473, which is lower than EPP of platinum. So it was the first success we achieved that, you know, it was really good enough, where EPP was less than the conventional platinum electrode, as well as the current density also was slightly higher, 3.96 milliamp per centimeter squared J value when compared to that of platinum, 2.18. So this further triggered us to further work on this vanadium nitride materials to really show what is the factor that is really causing the increase in the efficiency. And this was a routine analysis to find the stability analysis and different scan rate analysis. Typically, scan rate analysis are done to study whether the reaction is occurring via diffusion process. So it obeyed the scan rate analysis, means that there's a proper diffusion happening. And again, as you can see here, electrochemical impedance spectroscopy, typically, it showed almost RS value. If you can see here, RS value of the vanadium nitrate is 10.15, whereas RS value of platinum, the solution resistance, is 10.12 ohms. It means that the resistance, you know, is just slightly more than platinum, and almost comparable to platinum, which means it's a really good material for as a counter electrode for dissensitized solar cell. And the diameter of the semicircle it represents the charge transfer resistance, which is almost again equal to that of the platinum. And if you see in the Tafel plot, which again tells me the electrocatalytic ability of the counter electrode, typically, as can be seen here, the diffusion in this case, for example, the black one is slightly higher with higher current density. It means the diffusion is happening, you know, properly in a very good way in the proposed material. That's the reason it was obeying this scan rate analysis. And coming to the device testing, we did a JSE curve, that is photocurrent efficiency, and it was found that the proposed material for vanadium nitrate, it was having a pretty good efficiency, higher than the platinum, 7.44, and with the VOC value of 0.792, and this should be typically higher, and JSC short circuit current of 15.63, which was all you know, higher than that of the platinum. It means that the proposed electrode, is really a good electrode, and further work is on the way to further improve the efficiency by engineering the material with you know, with the other factors to really improvise and, you know, make a product out of it. And so these, some of the other materials we have done, I'll just flip through quickly through all these slides to sum up. This was on, again, titanium nitride. Again, we did a lot of iteration in titanium nitride, and we did all the device level studies, but the efficiency of titanium nitride was typically less. So, I mean, it was not that good compared to vanadium nitride. And this is another paper which got recently accepted. This is on vanadium nitride zero gels typically, and though it was not showing good efficiency, but the stability was pretty good. When we observed for, you know, for 30 days time, the stability was not that decreasing. So we are further, you know, engineering this particular material, vanadium nitride. So in all the cases, vanadium compounds, the family of vanadium materials are typically showing good results. So this is yet another work. To sum up, these are some of the materials. I mean, what my PhD student has basically done on different types of materials. She has done a systematic study on morphology, on making a composite, on, and, you know, on interfacial engineering, typically on various materials, and found that vanadium nitride typically has shown a good efficiency of 7.44 compared to platinum. And we did a comparative study also on the conventional platinum with 7.39 efficiency, whereas vanadium nitride showed 7.44 efficiency. And now we are slowly moving into the flexible. So vanadium nitride, we are now planning to make a flexible Dyson stay solar cell because of its good efficiency. And after fine-tuning in terms of interfacial engineering will be fabricated. And coming to the end of my presentation, so is there any scope for Dyson stay solar cell? Obviously, the answer is yes. A lot of scope, though efficiency now it's less compared to perovskite solar cells. It cannot beat, obviously, perovskite solar cells. But the cost of it, at least for some of the commercial applications, you know, low-level consumer applications can be developed using Dyson stay solar cells by improving the efficiency in terms of interfacial engineering of the photo anodic material, that is metal oxides, by doing band gap engineering. And number two, dyes. Dyes are very important because by just tuning the functionality of the dyes, we can dictate the dyes to absorb more photons. More photons means more electrons, more quantum efficiency, and creating new electrolytes. Typically, electrolytes are now the major issue because of the leakage happening, and because, you know, it needs to be replaced then and then. So creating new electrolytes typically that can provide a higher voltage and thereby increasing the efficiency. And finally, to work on the stability that can, you know, so that DSSC typically can last for many years. So these are some of the applications of Dyson stay solar cells, we all know. And so to finally sum up all the research, what we are doing at CNR, our center, it's according to the Sustainable Development Goal 2030. And we are working on clean energy, renewable energy, and affordable and clean energy. So with that, thank you very much for your kind attention, and I'd be happy to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nirmala Grace, for the great presentation. It's definitely great to hear about your center, to hear about your research activities. I see a lot of synergies between our research labs in this area and your research. So hopefully this will encourage more collaboration between our faculty and students, and your faculty and your students. Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Mohammed.
So at this point, we'd like to open it up for questions. As always, please feel free to unmute yourself and ask a question, or feel free to type it into the chat, and we will direct it to Dr. Nirmala Grace for her consideration.
I have one question.
Yes, hi,
Yes, this is Jung Hyun Cho from Binghamton University.
Professor
in Chemical Engineering and Material Science. At the last part of your presentation, you mentioned about the flexible solar cell. Is that flexible solar cell using the Dyson stay solar cell technique?
Yes, it's possible. That's what actually we just started the work. Though we were in the earlier days, we are doing on rigid substrates. Now it's all on flexible solar cells because you know, that's a USP of our center as well. And flexible solar cell, obviously, it can be incorporated in a lot of consumer products. So end of the day, flexible Dyson stay solar cells would be really useful in terms of commercialization and development of products.
For that, what's the substrate you are using for the flexible?
Flexible, it's polyethylene naphthalate on ITO, PE and ITO. For the
For Dyson's the solar cell, actually, you mentioned about actually involving those photo anode fabrication that involves some high temperature processing. So how do you actually resolve that issue if you're using that?
High temperature, the temperature is going to it's affect the electrolyte, right? Electrolyte may become volatile, it may degrade also. So that is what actually the basic or the major disadvantage of a Dyson stay solar cell compared to perovskite solar cells. And to cater that, research is basically going on, like how to increase, the temperature span in terms of, development of new electrolytes or in terms of development of new dyes. So it's research is underway, though we are not actually working on the electrolytes, but definitely, obviously, it needs to be improved for viable applications. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Cho and Dr. Grace. Any other questions? Again, feel free to...
I have a general question. And first of all, I'd like to thank you for a wonderful presentation. Really enjoyed the summary of the technology and all the detailed work you've done. It's really impressive. One general question I have is in India, where do you see this technology going forward? In the US, a company named Konarka a number of years ago didn't fare well and closed because and maybe they were too early to get the technology out. Is there a new wave in interest for these technologies, and will we see them manufactured perhaps in India or somewhere else?
Solar technology is it's like blooming in India, and though there are a few industries who are working on solar, like Tata, and but now I think even the government of India has taken a lot of initiatives to develop this technology, to commercialize and build a lot of units across India. Very recently, I think they have installed a big unit in the northern part of India, and a lot of industries now coming in to fund this particular technology, because our nation is blessed with a very hot climate, and maybe down the lane, definitely this technology is definitely would be commercialized in our country with the help of the government and in many industries.
That's great. That's great. Yeah. Thank you very much for a wonderful
talk. Thank you. Thank you. Yeah.
Thank you. Any other questions from our colleagues in the US or in India?
I have a question. Professor Nirmala, I just wanted to understand the dye electrolyte component. You did mention that there were two separate chemicals. One is the dye, which is, I think, an organic extract. And then the electrolyte is a different compound. So from the manufacturing of the solar cell, is it that they're mixed into one layer and then coated, or are they coated as separate layers? I just wanted to understand. I wasn't clear about that.
Yes, yes. See, in the photo anodic part is coated with the semiconducting material, N-type semiconducting material, that is titanium dioxide. And on the other side, that is on the cathodic part, transparent conducting oxides are basically coated with platinum that becomes the photocathode or the counter electrode typically. And so in between these two glass substrates, imagine that there's an arbitrary space, there's nothing. And this is Sirlin spacer. Spacer is just like, imagine there's an O-ring, there's a rubber kind of, imagine it's not rubber, basically it's a rubber kind of ring, it's a spacer. And in between that, we have, when it is fabricated, you will get a small space when a spacer is introduced between the photocathode and the anode. So there is in between that space, electrolytes are typically injected. So the dye is typically attached to the cathodic part, and the electrolyte is it's like floating between the anodic as well as the cathodic part. And because of that only, the electrolyte stability is very important. There's a lot of chance of leakage happening, and when there's a leakage happening, there's a lot of regeneration will be happening in the energy diagram what I explained. So it's basically sitting in the space between the photocathode and the photoanodic part. And the spacer material, just like O-ring called a Serlin material, is preventing these electrolytes typically to come out from the cell.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you very much. Any other questions?
I may piggyback and add another, ask another question.
Yes, yes.
There isn't anyone else. So understanding that, I wanted to know whether it is possible to just extend the scope of the organic layer to perform both absorption as well as the electrolysis part, so that it's not two separate compounds with a spacer in between. Basically, it's like a N-type material, so that you have a PN junction type of an arrangement. Is there any, are you aware of any disensitized solar cell along those lines, or is there any research being conducted along those lines? Yeah. Could you please tell us?
Yeah, that's a nice thought. See, typically dyes should be integrated with the photoanodic part that is on the N-type semiconducting materials, because it's a dye that is going to absorb the photons and not the titanium dioxide, it being a semiconductor. So dye is going to help the semiconducting molecules to absorb photons that is coming from the sunlight. And therefore, dyes should be always anchored to the semiconducting materials, that is titanium dioxide. And so far, I mean, there are no research on, making a molecule, organic molecule, which does both the job of electrolyte as well as the organic dyes. Dyes are totally different, which absorbs, and electrolytes are totally, they are inorganic materials, typically iodine triiodide system, which is needed for this electrochemical reversibility. But maybe anchoring iodine triiodide on an organic molecule and creating a complete new molecule, just my thought. But as such, I haven't read any papers on that, combining organic and inorganic materials.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Any other questions from our colleagues in India or here in the US? Okay. If not, I'd like to, again, on behalf of Binghamton University and Vellore Institute of Technology, I'd like to thank Dr. Nirmala Grace for the wonderful presentation, to hear more about the capabilities and research labs and the wonderful work that you're doing with your students and colleagues. We have definitely enjoyed your presentation, and we hope that this will open up a lot of opportunities for collaboration between Binghamton University and VIT in this area. And I would also like to invite everyone to join us next week for the next presentation. The next presentation will be done by Dr. Peter Borgeson. And this is the title of his presentation. This is an ongoing project that he's working on, collaborating with several faculty here at Binghamton University. Dr. Peter Borgeson is a professor of system science and industrial engineering, and he works very closely with Dr. Pollux, who is our director of the Center for Advanced Microelectronics Manufacturing in a wide range of areas. So again, as we discussed early in the session, due to the daylight savings here in the US, the time will change to seven. Yeah, this is not accurate, but in India, it will be 7 to 8 p.m. And in the US, it will remain 8:30 to 9:30 a.m. So the time in India will be 7 to 8 p.m. And in the US is 8:30 to 9:30 p.m. So this is inaccurate. We will fix it. But again, this is the next presentation that we will be conducted as part of this joint webinar series between Binghamton University and VIT. And we hope that you will join us again next week. Later today, I will send the recording for Dr. Nirmala Grace's presentation. So if you have any colleagues who could not make it because of conflicts, please feel free to share with them the recording for the seminar, and also feel free to invite them to join us next week. Once again, on behalf of Binghamton University and DIT, thank you for joining us today and look forward to seeing everyone next week.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Mohammed.
Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you, Nirmala. Hi. Bye, Bruno. Take care.
Thanks. Bye.